Brothers and sisters in Islam, praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for making us Muslims. Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for showing us the path to guidance. Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for putting us into nations and tribes so that we may know one another. Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the one who brought the night from the day, and the one who brought the day from the night. If we were to live a day where there was no night, who other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would bring us day where we live our lives? And likewise, if we were to live in a day where there was no night, who other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would bring us a night where we find rest? Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving superiority of some months over others. Brothers and sisters in Islam, every day we live on the face of this earth, we take the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But are we grateful? Are we grateful for these blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showers over us? Brothers and sisters in Islam, O slaves and O worshippers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are living in these days, which is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The fact that He gave us life to see these days, the blessing of Ramadan. Ramadan has blessings. Do we know these blessings? Are we grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the blessings that we see in Ramadan? Ramadan, brothers and sisters in Islam, has many blessings. Many blessings. And it's impossible to talk about the blessings of Ramadan in one khutbah. But here, we'd like to point very briefly to some of the blessings that we Muslims all over the world we see in Ramadan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. And if you were to count, and if you had to encompass or try to encompass the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you wouldn't be able to. So what are the blessings? What are the blessings that we see in Ramadan? The first blessing of Ramadan is that it teaches us taqwa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. O you who believe, fasting has become obligatory on you, so that you can achieve taqwa, so that you can achieve piety, so that you can fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And taqwa, piety, is one of the two qualities that will be a reason for you to go to Jannah. Imam al-Bukhari narrates in his book Al-Adab al-Mufrad, where a narrator, a man, one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, went to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he asked, or she asked, what are the two things that will be a reason for me to go to Jannah? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, taqwallah and husnul khuluq. To fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to have good character, to have good values. So one of the blessings of Ramadan is that this is a time where we achieve taqwa. We become pious. We fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by implementing His commands in the Quran and the commands of His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Sunnah. Another blessing of Ramadan is that it teaches us many wonderful qualities, because a Muslim that takes his deen from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had the perfect qualities, the most perfect qualities and the most perfect habits belong to him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In many parts of the Quran and in many parts of the Sunnah does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praise those people that are generous. It's been narrated in Sahih Muslim that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was the most generous man. كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أجود الناس بالخير وكان أجود ما يكون في شهر رمضان حين يلقاه جبريل. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he was the most generous man. Most generous man in terms of goodness. He would always be there ready to assist and help and aid and lend a hand to his companions who needed help. And he would reach the height of his generosity in the month of Ramadan, because the hadith says, وَكَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمْ أَجْوَدُ النَّاسِ بِالْخَيْرِ وَأَجْوَدُ مَا يَكُونُ فِي رَمَضَانِ. And he would reach the peak of his generosity in Ramadan when he would meet Jibreel alayhi salam, and Jibreel alayhi salam would revise with him the Quran. So this is where the Muslims take their qualities and their values, those good qualities and their values. We take it from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is the time where you're supposed to be generous. This is the time where you're supposed to lend and you're supposed to help. This is the time where you're supposed to aid. This is the time when you are supposed to assist those people. Be generous in any way possible. In the same hadith in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet the narrator of the hadith, he says, "Kan ajwadu min ar-rih al-mursala." That the Prophet ﷺ, he was more generous than the passing wind. Because the passing wind, it moves the clouds. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings from behind, moving the clouds, he brings rain. And he brings this blessing for the good and the bad. Al-barr wal-fajr. He brings the blessing of rain after he moves the clouds by his wind, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he pours his mercy on that land that was dead, that didn't see any water. And then from that land, mankind, the good and the bad, they eat from those crops and they feed the animals. And they have all types of goodness. Another type, another blessing of Ramadan, another blessing of Ramadan that we see time in and time out again is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he rewards the fasting people with a reward that has no limit. When you, every deed that you do, you get rewarded. And this reward that you get, it's known, except for fasting. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says it is a deed that is done for him. And only he rewards the fasting people. And in Bukhari and Muslim, there's another hadith where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward the fasting person by letting them enter Jannah from the door of Rayyan. And the door of Rayyan, that would be the doorway. Only the fasting people will enter Jannah through this door. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, how it's been narrated in Sahih Muslim, kullu amal ibn Adam lah. Kullu amal ibn Adam lah illa siyam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, kullu amal ibn Adam, kullu amal ibn Adam lah illa siyam, fa innahu li wa ana ajzi bih. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the deeds of every son of Adam is for him, except for fasting, because it is done for me. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he rewards him. The great scholar Al-Qurtubi, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on him, he says that every son of Adam has a deed, and this deed is known. And this is like the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he says, "Kullu amal ibn Adam, okay, al hasanatu bi ashar, kullu amalin ibn Adam al hasanatu bi ashar amthaliha ila 700 dhif." That every deed is for the son of Adam, and you will get rewarded from 10 to 700 folds, except for fasting. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِنَّهُ لِي وَأَنَا أَجْزِي بِهِ. For this fasting is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he will reward you for it. So the reward that you get for fasting, which is a blessing from Allah, because he gave you the ability, the life, he gave your heart the command to beat in Ramadan and for you to be amongst the people that are alive. And you're fasting for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you, inshallah, with rewards that have no limits. Another blessing that we see in Ramadan is after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like it's been narrated in the books of Sunnah, after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was thrown out of his house, after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was thrown out of his city, Mecca, and the Muslims were tortured, and they were persecuted, and they witnessed all sorts and all types of torture and pain, and all types of harshness from the enemies of Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded his messenger to emigrate to Medina. And then after a period of time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, an army of 300 men plus a little more, the Battle of Badr, that happened in the month of Ramadan. They went out when they heard that Abu Sufyan and the caravan of Quraysh was coming back, heading for Mecca, which was full of goods. The Prophet ﷺ discussed it with his companions, and they set out only to meet the caravan, only to get some of the goods on the caravan. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has wisdom. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does things from His wisdom subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when the Muslims set off to try and get this caravan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala set a meeting point between the soldiers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the soldiers of shaitan. And here you have one of the first victories of Islam. An army of 300 and plus men overcome an army from between 900 to 1,000 men. It was a victory that happened in Ramadan. One of the biggest blessings that the Muslims in the time the Prophet ﷺ witnessed was when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them some of their courage, and so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them triumph over their enemies. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ نَصَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ بِبَدْرٍ وَأَنْتُمْ أَذِلَّةٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ نَصَرَكُمْ, and we gave you victory in Badr, وَأَنْتُمْ أَذِلَّةٌ, and you were a few, and you were a small army. فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and be amongst those who are grateful. And then after Badr, by some time, you have the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He gets all the Muslims and they go and they do Umrah. They go and they do Umrah to walk around the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, only to be stopped just before they enter Masjid al-Haram. And then you have that famous pact that happened between the Muslims and the Quraysh, Al-Hudaybiyah. And then the Prophet ﷺ slaughtered his animal that he brought from Medina to go and slaughter it in the house of Allah, and he went back to Medina. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inna fatahna laka fathan mubina. That this was a fath, this is the conquest of Mecca, that amongst majority of the Islamic historians happened in the month of Ramadan. So the Prophet ﷺ, after he was kicked out of his house, after he was thrown out, after the Muslims were tortured, and they witnessed all types of abuse, physical abuse, financial abuse, the Prophet ﷺ left to go to Medina. And after a number of years, the Prophet ﷺ came back to Mecca. After Hudaybiyah, he came back, and Mecca became an Islamic city. The Muslims were allowed to walk around the Kaaba, circumambulating, doing tawaf. Mecca became an Islamic city until the Day of Judgment. So these are some of the blessings that happened to Muslims that we should think about in Ramadan. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those Muslims that truly see the blessings of Ramadan. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those Muslims that are accepted in the month of Ramadan, and to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those Muslims that are saved from the fire of Jahannam in the month of Ramadan. Ameen. If we understand that we are in a blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we're in a month that can change our lives. These blessings, we need to be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to be grateful to Him for these blessings. And one of the ways to be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to stay away from wrong. Now there are many mistakes, there are many misconceptions that some Muslims believe and some Muslims do that will eat away at our blessings. If we truly want Ramadan to be a time where we change our lives, if we truly want to triumph in Ramadan and be victorious and be amongst those people that are accepted, we have to make sure that we don't wash away our blessings with sin. There are some errors, some mistakes that Muslims do that can eat away at the hasanat, that can eat away at the rewards. And I'd like to take this opportunity to just mention a few of them. The first mistake that many of us fall into is that we should be conscious over uttering false speech and witnessing falsehood. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not need you to stay away from food and drink and stay away from your sexual desires. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is most rich. He has angels that worshipping Him from the day the earth and the heavens have been created. So you need to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with your taqwa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes your piety. Your deeds are for you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in authentic hadith, like it's been narrated in the books of Sunnah, "Man lam yad' qawl az-zur wal 'amal bihi wal jahla, falaysa lillahi hajatun an yad' ta'amahu wa sharabah." That one who doesn't leave uttering false speech, and that one who doesn't leave looking at falsehood, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not in need for him to leave his food and his drink. Allah doesn't need him to leave his food and his drink. Many of us, we think fasting is engage in all the verbal desires that I have. Joke with this one, slander this one, backbite that one, mock that one. And we fasting and we stay away from our food and drink. And then Maghrib time comes and then we break our fast and we engage in more slandering and more backbiting. Those people that can't control their tongues, those people that can't control their eyes and they look at evil, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't need them to fast and to leave their food and their drink. Another mistake that many Muslims make is because they are so anxious to try and make the fasting easy for themselves, and they try and stay awake in the night. Some of them stay up until suhoor to try and drink and eat so that when they wake up in the day, they won't feel their fast. So they stay up the whole night, and then after Fajr they go to sleep, and some of them miss the obligatory salah. Some of them miss the obligatory salah, and this is wrong. This is wrong, and this eats away at your hasanat, at your rewards of your fasting. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Surah Maryam, O Taha, after He mentions the prophets, He mentions Idris, and then He mentions Ibrahim, and then He mentions Isa. After Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions all these prophets, and some of their qualities was they would fall down in prostration when they heard the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and their followers. After Allah mentions the qualities of the prophets and some of their followers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the qualities of the people that came after them. فَخَلَفَ مِنْ بَعْدِمْ خَلْفٌ أَضَاعُ الصَّلَاةَ وَاتَّبَعُ الشَّهَوَاتِ فَسَوْفَ يَلْقَوْنَ غَيَّا. These people that came after these prophets, who from their characteristics, from their values, these were people that were so pious, when they heard the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they would fall down in prostration, glorifying Him and praising Him. And also this was the teaching that these prophets, they passed on to their followers, the pious followers. Then after these people came people that submitted to their desires. The great scholar Ibn Kathir, he says, "Adha'u salat" means they started praying salah in time that wasn't its prescribed time. So they would pray, for example, dhuhr, they wouldn't pray dhuhr in its time. They wouldn't pray asr in its time. And this is wrong. And the Prophet ﷺ says in one hadith, which is authentic, that I wished I could give a command for a man to give the iqamah. This authentic hadith in the Prophet ﷺ, where he says, I wished I could give the iqamah for a man to give the iqamah and the salah to be for salah to stand. Thumma ukhalifu ila rijalin, and then I go with some of my men to the people alladhina la yashhadun as-salah, to the people that don't pray salah, fa uharriqu alayhim buyutahum, and I burn those tents of those men that don't witness salah in jama'ah. It's very important, brothers and sisters in Islam, for a man to establish his prayer in the jama'ah. In Ramadan, because we are too busy and we all occupied with eating and drinking in the night, and we're up at dhuhr time, we are sleeping. The muadhin is saying hayya ala salah, hayya ala falah, and we are sleeping. And some of us miss dhuhr, and we prayed in its time. Some Muslims pray dhuhr in its time, but just before asr. Some Muslims are so evil, they pray dhuhr in the time of asr. A'udhu billah. Some Muslims, and they're fasting, they're thinking they're doing a good deed. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't need your good deeds if your good deeds are going to come to the expense of another bad deed, a major sin. Salah is the most important pillar after the shahadatain. One of the salaf says, if you are negligent on your salah, you will be negligent with everything that's after salah. The most important pillar for a Muslim after La ilaha illallah and Muhammad Rasulullah is salah. If you are negligent in your salah, you're going to be negligent on the things that come after salah. Your salah is repeated 5 times a day. Ramadan comes once in a year. So some Muslims, they stay up in the night and then they are negligent in their salah. And one of the last mistakes that I'd like to bring your guys' attention to is that, and I'd like all the brothers and the sisters here to throw their ears to what's going to be said now, because this is wisdom from the Quran and the Sunnah. Brothers, 9 days of Ramadan have passed, and there's an authentic hadith where once the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he ascended the minbar. He ascended the pulpit and he said, Ameen, Ameen, Ameen. So the prophets, the companions, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with them, they asked him, oh Messenger of Allah, we saw you do something that we never saw you do. We never saw you do this. So the Prophet says, Jibreel came to me and asked me to say Ameen. He came to me and asked me to say Ameen 3 times. And every time he asked me to say Ameen, he mentioned a vice. He mentioned a mistake that some of the Muslims in this ummah he make. And one of those mistakes is رَغِمَ أَنْفُ رَجُلٍ دَخَلَ عَلَيْهِ رَمَضَانٍ فَانْسَلَخْ فَلَمْ يُغْفَرْ لَهُ. May that believer who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him Ramadan, and Ramadan starts and it finishes, and his sins are not forgiven. May he put his soul in sand. He's lost. May he put his nose in sand to that extent of humiliation. That extent of humiliation, may he put his nose in sand. This person, he witnesses Ramadan, and 30 days Ramadan starts and Ramadan ends, and he is not forgiven for his sins. He is not forgiven for his sins. Why? Because Ramadan, he wasn't serious. He never used to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. He wasn't serious in rectifying himself. He wasn't serious in purifying himself. He wasn't serious in letting go of his sins. These sins will come back to him on the day of Qiyamah. So we're in a time where the doors of Jannah have been opened and the doors of fire have been shut, and the shayateen, they've been locked, they've been handcuffed. This is the time, O son of Adam, O daughter of Adam, repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Seek his repentance. Seek his repentance. Wash yourselves from your sins. After your salah, when you break your fast, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for repentance. To a certain extent, where the Prophet says, may that person, he hasn't been forgiven in Ramadan, may he put his nose in sand to that extent of humiliation.